Good morning, Clinton College family. It is my pleasure to be leading us in invocation today. Everyone, please bow your heads. Everyone, please bow your heads. Dear Lord, we come to you as humbly as we know how. We want to say thank you. Thank you for your grace and your mercy. Thank you for everything that you've done in our lives and everything that you continue to do. Lord, please surround us with your love and your peace and your mercy and your protection. In your name we pray, amen.
Good morning to our faculty, staff, and students at Clinton College, our Clinton College extended family, our supporters, and our viewers who may be joining us today via the different streams. My name is Dr. Angela Brown, Vice President of Student Success and Dean of Students here at Clinton College, and I'm excited to be your moderator today for our second annual Glass Ceiling Conversations. This project was really born out of an opportunity to highlight the accomplishments of minority women during Women's History Month. And so without further ado, what I'd like to do is introduce to you our dynamic panel for today's discussion. They are all trailblazers in their own right. They have all managed to navigate their way successfully breaking through glass ceilings to be a success in their chosen field. So we're going to get right started with the introductions of our guest panel today. First, we have Dr. Sheila Higgs Burkhalter. And Dr. Burkhalter has a managerial degree from the University of Arkansas in Student Affairs Administration. She has a master's in that field from Indiana University. And she's affectionately known as Shigs. She currently serves as the Vice President for Student Affairs at Winthrop University, which is right across the street from us. And happy to say we have forged a wonderful relationship. She proudly carries the title as the first Black senior leader over at Winthrop University. And she was named the 2023 NASPA Pillar of the Profession. So we want to say congratulations to her. Her career spans over 8 institutions, over 28 years of serving our students. Dr. Burkhalter is motivated and is a focused educator who's committed to student success and cultivating innovative and transformative, vibrant campuses. She's also the owner of her own consulting business, Shigs B Coaching. So we want to say welcome to Dr. Burkhalter. We also have with us today Ms. Kimberly Mobley, and she is an architect with Brownstone architecture firm. She also was an architect at Gant Huberman. And what makes her special, because I've just been wanting to tell this, so I'm going to go straight to it. Ms. Mobley is the architect of our library here on the campus of Clinton College, our beautiful, wonderful library. She does have some acknowledgments. She has been recognized by Mecklenburg Times as Charlotte's 50 most influential women. And she is also a mentor in our community. So I want to give a warm welcome to Ms. Mobley. Welcome. We also have coming all the way from New Mexico, Dr. Thomasina Ortiz Gallegos. She's the Associate Vice President of Student Affairs at New Mexico Santa Fe Community College. She has a deep passion for education and helping others who are aspiring towards their goals and aspirations, and has worked for more than 27 years serving in multiple capacities in higher education. She is a proud first-generation college undergraduate with a doctorate in organizational leadership with an emphasis in higher education. Dr. Gallegos's work motto is meet our students where they are and let's take them where they want to be. Dr. Gallegos, I'm going to have to take that and remember that. So I appreciate that. Yes. You all get your pens out. You all get your pens out because you guys are going to get some great knowledge today. We are not done yet. We also have Ms. Jasmine D. Cunningham. So there she is. Now, I'm just going to put it out there. I've known this young lady a long time. I was sharing with the parents. I know her before she got her driver's license. So I am so proud of this young lady here. Anybody who knows me knows I love sports. And so this is real special for us because when we talk about glass ceiling conversations, she embodies that. Ms. Cunningham is a former member of the inaugural Division I golf team and 2018 graduate of the University of Maryland Eastern Shore, earning her degree in PGA Golf Management and Hospitality and Tourism. In 2019, she was the 8th African-American woman elected to Class A membership with the PGA of America. During her time at UMES, she held several leadership positions. She also graduated summa cum laude. So again, we are welcoming Miss Cunningham. I didn't give y'all what she does. She is a player development representative at Titleist, and she outfits and makes sure that all of our HBCUs, their golf teams, have the items that they need. So we want to welcome Miss Jasmine Cunningham. So welcome to all of you guys. I can't wait to get started. And like I said to our guests, to all of our students, if you all don't have pen and paper and pencil, go get it right now, because the dropping of the lessons is about to start. We're going to start off with our first question to each of you guys. And I'll just go as I see you all across the screen here. How important is to have a college education? When we look at how you guys are successful, how important is that? How important was getting that education? I'm going to start off with Dr. Burkhalter, and then we're just going to work our way around.
Well, good morning, everyone. And I will say that I think it is extremely important. I, like Dr. Tomasina Ortiz-Gallegos, I'm a first generation college student. And so to be sitting in this place and space at this time, 28 years later, helping other students through this journey is extremely important to me, but it would not have been possible had I not gotten my education. So I think it is absolutely critical. I think everybody's pathway is different, whether that's getting an associate's or, you know, starting at a four-year institution or taking a gap year. But I think education is the key to opening so many doors because of the exposure that it gives. I'll leave it there because I know my friend and colleague will have a lot more to say.
Yes, yes. Now, you guys have to remember, everybody on here is educated, and y'all know one thing that we all like to do is talk. So what that's why I say y'all better get your papers out and start recording. Ms. Mobley, what do you have? What do you have for us in terms of education?
Yes, I have a thing or two to say about it. I am also a first generation, not necessarily a first generation, but I am a nearly first generation college graduate. And it's been instilled in me that our education gives you options. I mean, it's a way for you to sustain yourself, make sure that you have a sense of independence. It broadens your mind. Those are the paramount reasons why you want to pursue an education. Also, to get you at the seat of the table. I mean, just as we just heard, the reason we're here today is because it gives you a seat to influence it. Things in the community that's important to you. I mean, to have the credential means a lot, especially as African-American women. We need to have whatever we need to have to get in the conversation and stay there.
So. Absolutely. Thank you so much. And Ms. Cunningham, probably out of all of us, our most recent, if we say the rest of us might be on the other side of the hill. She's probably the only one that actually remembers her graduation. Ms. Cunningham, what do you have for us?
Yes, thank you so much for having me today. So graduated in 2018, so I feel like it's been a few years, you know. I am getting a little older, but, you know, a college education is extremely important. I went to an HBCU, so that was extremely important for me. You know, besides learning meaningful education, you know, I really got to understand who I am as a woman and what I want out of life. And, you know, I also got to be around other people that looked like me, which was super important. Being that I play golf and not a lot of Black people or people of color play golf, I got to go to an HBCU where other people looked like me that also played golf. So that was extremely important for me to be around. And, you know, college definitely gave me the tools that I needed to manage my time, you know, increase my chances for employment, and just really opening the door for different opportunities, such as networking and meeting different types of people. So
Right. Thank you. Oh, my goodness. You guys said some wonderful things. I mean, what I just wrote down, we talked about having a seat at the table. Mm-hmm. We talked about increasing our chances, right? And so, those are great nuggets. And you guys get ready. Dr. Galagos is going to share with her. And Dr. Galagos, I want to thank you for being on again, because when we say African-American, we're talking about, right, I'm talking about minorities. This is for all minorities. So thank you, because we also know included in that is our Latina sisters who also face some of those same, right, limiting challenges, those same ceilings. So I'm so glad that you're able to join in the conversation. So if you would share your thoughts on that.
Absolutely. And what a beautiful blessing it is to be here with all of us, speaking on something that is so incredibly important to all people of color. But, you know, without education, we all wouldn't be here today. That is absolutely true. But also the blessings that came with that education. So we have to have a seat at the table, which gets us there from our education. We have to have the voice, which is the knowledge that we gain from all of the education. But the experiences and the people that we get to meet throughout that process is, I think, entirely that much more important. Education and our knowledge and our books and our wisdom that we get is beautiful, but sharing it with each other, like what we're doing here today, is what really adds value, that co-curricular opportunity to really bring it all together and share it with one another. That's what's really helping promote us and get us to that next step. And being together and sharing all of this to really help get us going to the next step. That's what's important. We got to empower one another. And through education is one of the first steps of doing so.
Wow. Awesome. Dr. Galagos, I want to start with you on this next one, because you kind of led us right on in. We talked about having a voice, being at the table, and then you talked about having that empowerment. And so I wanted you to start us off with our next topic, which was, what are those characteristics that you think are really key, you know, in your field, getting us to the table, and not just getting us to the table, like you said. It's not enough for us to sit at the table. It's about having a voice. Like, I don't want to sit there being muted. It's having a voice. So what are some of those characteristics that you think are critical to the success in the field that you chose, or those persons that aren't in education, but, you know, they're facing some of those same challenges? Tell us about that.
Well, you know, I don't know about my friends here this morning, but I feel like the imposter syndrome always comes through. And it doesn't matter how many years of experience, how many degrees, titles you have. It is hard, because sometimes you look around the table and you're the only person of color. You're the only female. You're the only whatever it is at that moment. And it makes you me cringe for a minute, thinking, one, how sad it is that happens too oftentimes, and two, am I really here for intention? And what are those intentions, and how do I make sure that I can bring forward, not just speaking on behalf of all people who look like me, but also for all those who don't have a voice? So it's finding that confidence. It's finding, it's being okay with being the only one and knowing the purpose that you're there, because you are just as deserving as anyone else who is there. So really making sure that you find that confidence and that you're able to say it and speak it and articulate it in a way that is meaningful and comes from the heart and from the soul, and that it's not just something that you read the other day in a book, but it's something that you have felt, you felt, and you've lived. So really being truthful with yourself and being able to inspire others with how it is what you say, what you mean, and really go forward with those who you are doing it for. And I think leading with your heart is definitely something that is extremely important, no matter what table you're at and no matter whose voice you're trying to share.
Awesome. Thank you. I'm going to help you guys, all my note takers, my students, you guys are in class. I'm going to help you keep up with these notes. She talked about confidence. She said, say it, speak it. Say it, speak it, and that you have to be okay with being the only one in the room, which is a perfect segue into Miss Cunningham. She already knows. That's why she was shaking her head. We are already on the same wavelength. We know one place that you go as a Black person on a golf course or wherever the golf arena is, you probably are the only one at the table. So, Miss Cunningham, that is a perfect segue. How do you handle being comfortable with being the only one, and still having what Dr. Gallegos talked about, the confidence to say it and speak it.
Yeah, so it is definitely extremely hard, but to your point, you know, you have to be okay with being the only one in the room to help set the standard for what is going to come after. You know, you have to be able to set that example for those who are going to come after, and it's not going to be easy, but you definitely have to persevere through those hard times and stay motivated and remember what your why is. Sometimes we may forget what our why is, but I'm always reminded when I get frustrated and when I'm like, oh my gosh, I wish I wasn't the only person in the room. At the end of the day, you know, I have to be happy that I'm in the room, first of all, to be at the table, but also understand what I can do to help the generation behind me. So really being able to persevere through those things, you know, having the patience and willpower to keep going when things get tough, because they will. And it's so important to continue to stay, you know, down through those hard times and get back up. As many times as you get knocked down, you have to keep getting back up, because those are going to be key parts to your story when you tell your story later. You know, nobody wants to hear about, people want to hear about the things that you do, but people want to hear about the times that were hard. People want to hear about those failures, if you will, because those are going to motivate the people behind you to kind of, you know, get to where they want to get to. So.
Absolutely. Thank you for sharing that. And she talked about being happy in that role, being, again, being okay, the perseverance, the confidence. Amazing. And again, that is a perfect segue into one of the most positive people I know, Dr. Burkhalter, which is probably why she has 100% positivity rate with her business of helping people get to the next level. So Dr. Burkhalter, if you could tell us what you think some of the key characteristics are in being successful as a minority. Yeah.
Absolutely. So, you know, as somebody who sits at a table where I'm the first one, was the first one in 132 years and still am. So we're 136 years in and I'm still sitting at that table by myself, but I'm not by myself. And that's the thing I think is really important to remember. So I have a self-assurance that is born out of a strong inner compass that is based in values, but also my faith in God. So when I walk into that space, even though from the outside looking in, it looks like I am alone, that I am by myself, what I know for sure is that I bring with me all the hopes and dreams and expectations of everybody who had a part in getting me to that table, and all the student voices that I am representing when I sit in that space. So in addition to that self-assurance, I partner that with resilience. Not everything will go my way. Not everything will work in the ways that I want it to. Sometimes there are microaggressions. Sometimes people say things that really would blow your mind. But what I say to people when it comes to shattering glass ceilings is that it's not one big moment where you find yourself at the table. Mm-hmm. It is a thousand tiny fractures every step along the way of your journey. Mm-hmm. And if you're learning the lessons and putting the tools in your toolbox that will prepare you for that seat, then you'll have everything that you need. The other thing I say to people is having the seat isn't enough. So sometimes people get there and they're like, I can put my feet up now. This is amazing. I've arrived. Really, the hard work truly begins when you walk into that space, because when you burst through that ceiling, when you crack it, when you shatter it, there will be broken glass. There will be shards. There's going to be pointy places and spaces, because you're someplace where other people did not necessarily mean for you to be. Not all spaces were built with you in mind. So as you enter into those spaces, you need to know that there is still plenty of work to be done. But because you've been called, you've also been equipped. So get ready for what is ahead.
I need you to say that one again. I'm going to need you to say what? To so be called.
You've been called. You've been equipped, so you need to be ready for what is ahead, because really, the battles are still before you.
Yes, I love it. Absolutely love it. As you talked about, Dr. Burkhardt talked about, hey, when I break the ceiling, like there's some fragments around here and I have to be able to navigate that and still stay at the table, which is, again, leads us right into our next panelist, because she literally built some of these ceilings that we have up under us, right? Not the glass ceilings, but the concrete ceilings. And so again, when we talk about architecture, which I love, that's amazing. And we know, again, that truly is one of those fields where it's just not many of us, but somehow we were lucky enough to have her part of our Clinton team. Ms. Mobley, would you share with us your experience and talk about some of the characteristics that allowed you to break into architecture Yeah, as the builder of our library.
Yes, I love what I have heard, especially about the calling and being equipped with it. As an African-American female architect, I am proud to be part of what they call the first 500. It's less than 1% of registered architects in the country. There's like 400 architects, 450 African-American architects, and maybe 150,000 architects in the country. So we have a very small number, but we're part of the first 500 club. That's what we call ourselves.
Wow.
So I'm saying that to share that being the first one and the only one in the room is a norm. Just getting through the education, you'll find yourself there. But you learn those lessons of perseverance. I mean, that is the big one. And also intention and self-awareness are critical in these areas. I feel like architecture is a calling for me. Mm-hmm. It's the one thing I've been able to commit to consistently. And everyone we know and aspire to be like, of course, has a story, just as was indicated by Ms. Cunningham. You don't ever get to see that journey all the way to wherever the arrival spot is. And then we know that once we get there, that's where the work really begins. So I have been blessed and afforded many gifts from my mentorship through my professional life with Harvey Gantt and Human Architects, all of my colleagues along the way. And to be connected to the school was one of his gifts to me in terms of introduction to really embracing the service of the profession, to be able to come into an institution who at the time had 30 students enrolled. And it was like, okay, we really need to get on the track of accreditation. So, you know, the library is a key academic building and space to really establish accreditation for any institution. There's some focus there. And so the leadership there really was able to partner with Harvey, and he enabled me to walk the walk as an architect before I became licensed to usher the client through the process of architecture to develop this library that we're talking about today. So it's all about perseverance and understanding the why. Sometimes it gets a little fuzzy, but to be able to understand the power and the influence of those and that you have on that have prayed, you know, years and generations for you to have the opportunity to be able to pay it forward is the righteous call.
Wonderful, wonderful. I mean, look at that. I mean, you're talking about paying it forward. And I also heard in their mentorship and given those opportunities. And I have that on my sheet, and I'm going to come back. I want to circle back. But Ms. Cunningham, you talked about, you said, you know, all of our paths are not easy. I mean, everything is in a straight line. So I'm going to ask Ms. Mobley to start us off with this next one. The biggest challenges, like you said, sometimes our biggest challenge is somebody to believe that I can even do it without just prejudging, right? What we look like. So I'm going to ask each of you, what's the biggest challenge that you have faced on your journey to success as a minority? And then more importantly for our students and our viewers, how did you handle it? How did you handle it, right? Because we obviously didn't let it stop you. So Ms. Mobley, would you start us off with that?
Yes. Now, for myself, getting through school, K-12, and even through college, I had some challenges there. But most it went the way I planned it. It was not that big of a deal in terms of me to take one milestone and get to the next round. My challenge was licensure. Mm. At the time, I just fully expected to be able to breeze through the 9 exams, they say within 5 years, to really get that licensure that everybody is talking about in terms of the first 500. And for me, it was a gauntlet. I mean, it was something that really, where that perseverance lesson just kind of kicked in. And it taught me how to be humble. It taught me frustration. It taught me how to manage my time, focus in on what it is that I really am working for, why I'm doing it. And it has given me a sense of gratitude that nothing in the world can really give you unless you really have a struggle behind it. I mean, that's next generation. I hate to want to break it to you, but when it's anything of value, you're going to have to work for it. You're going to have to put some grind in it. You're going to have to struggle for it, because we understand that anything that you get and you know you've had to sacrifice for it, you cannot easily take that away from you, which is what we used to have. Just education was such a privilege to have it. And the reason we were so denied to have it was because it was something that no one could take away from you. There was a gratitude, an appreciation for it, which really should sustain, but that's really the value of getting together and understanding what education can do for an individual.
Mm-hmm. Awesome, guys. Did y'all hear it? Getting the grind, making through the struggle, but what's on the other side of that, nobody can take it away from you. When you get on the other side of that's awesome. Our next guest, Dr. Galagos, as a first generation college student, I know you had challenges. I know as a Latino vice president, as a female in that role, I know you had some challenges. Could you share with us how you handled those challenges?
Absolutely. You know, we all have choices. And when I graduated from high school many years ago, I didn't know I had the choice to go to college. It was there, but I wasn't sure what it was. As Ms. Mobley just said, it was a privilege. And so I selected that and I ran with it as much as I could. And I met the love of my life and decided to get married. So I kind of put education on hold for a minute. That was the challenge, because I was so hungry for it that I wanted it all. I wanted the beautiful family. I wanted the marriage. I wanted the education. And finding the balance was really hard for me from a cultural perspective, from my religion and my faith, from the finances, and trying to figure it all out. So between raising a family, I have three beautiful sons, and I have to give them a shout out because they helped me who I am today. And I have a supportive husband, and my parents were right there along with me, not knowing what it was that I was going towards. I didn't know what I was going towards, but I knew I needed something definitely, because once I got a little bit, I wanted more. So I got my associate's degree. I was like, heck yeah, this is great. I want more. Because it opened up doors, right? And I saw how it was almost a responsibility then at that point for the others who were watching me go through this process, not just my children, but my family, my community. I live in a very rural area and the pressure was real. And they were like, okay, you did this. So now what? How are you going to help us next? How are we going to get there through the next cycle of whatever it is you're going through? So my educational journey has been since high school until just, I think, back in 2017, 2018, when I finalized my doctorate. And then at that point, I said, okay, now what? What can I go to school for now? And my mom was like, give me a moment, my mama said. Please, no more school for a minute. But the challenge is how you work through them is finding the balance. You definitely need to understand what that is, because you can have it all. Don't let anyone tell you that you can't, because you can, but you have to work at it. And that work might mean giving up a night out so that way you could study. I was holding my babies, rocking them in my little rocker while I was typing on a typewriter. Yes, I'm going to date myself. Trying to talk about my babies,
right.
You know? Or going to the library instead of going to the park one day, you know, and also for me, it was putting God first every single time. And I felt like with God being my center, my core, everything else kind of just came to fruition when it should have. I was in a hurry, but there was a different plan for me. And so I had to just take that step back, accept where I was, and keep pushing towards where I wanted to be. Almost like the life that I want to give to my students. Is meeting them where they're at and taking them where they want to be. That's a life I had to lead. And really just finding all of that to be able to be humble and finding that support and being okay with asking for help. There is nothing
worse than
not asking for help when you need it, no matter what level or where you're at, because that's definitely what helps you persevere and push through the next steps.
Yes. Oh my goodness. Thank you. I heard it. I mean, balance and having it all. And I love to hear when people reaffirm, yes, you can. Right? It's just, hey, how do I get there to do it? We don't have to settle. Absolutely. And that brings us to Ms. Cunningham. Now, we know, how many times have you gone up to a golf course and somebody has said, well, yeah, concessions is over there. Concessions is over there, right? They're not even telling you where the greens are, because they're assuming that's not, you can't be here for that. So please tell us how you handled the challenges in such a glass ceiling dominated field of golf.
Absolutely. So, you know, the biggest challenge I feel like I faced, you know, I faced a lot growing up, but even in my career as well. So I will say, you know, growing up, I was told I was too pretty to play golf and I didn't look like a typical golfer. And being in middle school or high school and someone telling you that, that could be very detrimental to someone, you know, and that could be very threatening. And that could have stopped me right there, but I used it as motivation to get to where I wanted to get to today. But to prove everybody else wrong, but also to prove to myself that I was able to do it. And just feeling like I belong, because I feel like a lot of times throughout my career, I've walked into rooms and felt like I didn't belong. I've gone to golf courses and felt like I didn't belong, or I've worked in golf courses or at golf courses and I was mistaken as the shop girl, or, you know, selling the merchandise in the golf shop, and not having, you know, my credentials at the time, you know, obviously working towards that, but that was very difficult for me because it's like, is this what I have to look forward to? So, you know, once I got my credentials, you know, I'll keep saying it. I use, you know, the people behind me as my motivation, because I don't want them to go through the things that I had to go through, you know, in the golf industry. So it's important for me to set that example, to be a mentor to them, because I knew that I needed that growing up. But just feeling like, you know, encouraging people to tell them, hey, you do belong in this industry that doesn't represent our community well. And we still have a long way to go, but just staying patient through it all and just, again, realizing, you know, what is my why, and why is it that I want to be here? Because at the end of the day, you know, there are not a lot of people that look like me. But if I were to give up and not be here, that's one less person that is not here. You know, so that puts us back even further. So that's why I have to, you know, stay consistent and stay patient throughout the whole entire process to get, you know, Black people to where they need to get to. So it is very difficult, but, you know, you do have to remember why you belong there in the first place and allow your voice to be heard and allow your voice to give that perspective to the other white people that are in the golf industry to say, hey, that's not how, you know, that should be said, or, you know, so just providing your perspective and allowing them to understand where you're coming from, that plays a big difference.
Wow. I mean, I hope our students are listening. I hope our visitors have their pen and pencil, because now you're talking about a trailblazer that is unselfish. Obviously, what Ms. Cunningham is talking about, I hope y'all didn't miss it, she's been reaching back. She's been saying, hey, one of the reasons I keep going is because I got to make sure the next person can see that it can be done. So thank you for being an unselfish trailblazer. Dr. Burkhalter, can you share with us how you remain diligent among challenges?
Yeah, so what I will say is that there are challenges at every stage of the journey. As a first generation college student, when you enter into places and spaces that are unfamiliar to you, there is new language that you have to learn. There's inevitably somebody in some room that says that you do not belong there. There are people who will map your path for you as if they know where you're headed better than you know where you're headed. There'll be places where you're denied. As an undergraduate college student, I earned a job by phone via an interview and then showed up. And because I didn't look like how I sounded on the phone, they told me the job was no longer available. I could have gone back to my room and cried and been sad about my situation. But no, I went and found myself another job because I still have bills to pay. And then I learned from that how I would push through the next time someone tried to deny me something. I remembered that. I remember the lessons that I need to take into the next part of my journey. And so sometimes people will say negative things about you or attribute things to you that don't belong to you, or decide that you are something because of how you choose to show up and occupy a space. And what I say to that is, you need to use discernment to guide your choices. There is something beyond the people around you that guides you. It's passion, it's purpose, it's spirit. You need to listen to that, because there will be a chorus of voices, in addition to your supporters, who will indicate that you do not need to go certain places, that you do not need to try something out because it's too scary. Sometimes that very voice will come from within your own head. And somebody has already spoken about this in this space. Imposter syndrome will show up and say, no, no, don't do that. And really what people don't know about imposter syndrome is, in some ways, it's trying to protect you from the unknown. It's trying to keep you from hurting yourself. But this is when I say to people, this is when you need to tap into the other voice that is within you. It is intuition, and intuition is tied to spirit, and spirit is tied to something greater than you. That is the voice that you need to listen to, because there's something that you're supposed to be doing. And Jasmine has said this multiple times, just because you're first or an only or a different does not mean that you're going to be the last one. So you're teaching other people how to work with folks who look like us, walk like us, talk like us. And so if you don't complete your journey, if you don't accomplish the things that you are meant to accomplish, then think about the other people who may not get to occupy those places and spaces after you. Is that a burden? Is it heavy to carry? Absolutely. But we are chosen because we have the capacity to do this work, because we have what is within us that is necessary to pave that pathway for other people who will come behind us. So is it hard? Will there be challenges? As I said earlier, there's 1,000 tiny cracks that you make as you get ready to crack through a glass ceiling, but it is absolutely important for you to go through your own process of shattering so that you are stronger for the work that needs to be done once you burst through on the other side. Yes, there is sun that is there that you will get a chance to enjoy, but with that sunshine, you might also find that you have a few cuts and bruises along the way, but your cuts and bruises will mean that you'll smooth out those edges and make it easier for other people to pass through.
You better preach. Y'all ladies better get, I mean, it's so motivational. I mean, that's wonderful. You talked about discernment. I know everybody may not know, understand about the imposter syndrome, but I want you to explain it just to make sure everybody understands what you're talking about, Dr. Brett, in the most layman terms, so that our young people who may not have heard that, because that's an important lesson. When we talk about imposter syndrome versus our intuition. So I just want to go back to you for a second to give us that layman's term, what that means, so students can make sure they stay away from that, okay?
Absolutely. Imposter syndrome has a tendency to show up when we're in places and spaces that are new to us. And we start to wonder, do I deserve to be here? Am I smart enough? Do I have enough of the right things that I need to be successful in this environment? But intuition, which again, for me, is tied to spirit, it has you there. And what it does is it reassures you that you have exactly what you need. Remember, I started by saying when you are called, you are also equipped. So even though you can't always readily name what is necessary to get you through your journey, you've already been equipped with that before you walk through it. And here's what I encourage people to do. As you're moving through your life's journey, take the time to get still and journal and think about the lessons that you're learning along the way. You don't always know in that moment that it's a lesson that you will need for later, but I always tell people, I'm able to occupy this particular vice presidency and this particular space because of the lessons that I learned in my previous vice presidency. It was one of the hardest experiences that I have ever had. It was 8 years of all kinds of drama, because that's kind of what happens at the next level. There's a lot that comes at you. But the things that I learned there made me able to come into this environment with a sense of peace and calm and surety and self-assurance about what I was doing. One other vice president said to me once, I don't understand it. No matter what comes your way, you're able to just take it all in stride and you address it with confidence and with creativity. And at the end of the day, I said to him, it's because there's nothing new under the sun. I learned this someplace else, and it built within me knowledge, skills, abilities to go with the talent and gifting that God put in me to enable me to do this work with a sense of grace. And so everything that you're doing has purpose, and you may not always understand it, but walk it out, journal, learn, and know that all of it will become clear at the right time in your journey.
Wow. Called and equipped. Absolutely. Absolutely. And we were getting some great comments too. So this is kind of the last question, because I want to open it up for our guests to be able to engage with us. So I'm going to ask you guys to give us your kind of your brief response to this. But again, it is a theme that I'm hearing from each of you, because we do know that any successful person, I don't care who it is or what your journey is, you don't take it by yourself. How important is this? Because at school, this is also the place we know where we sometimes build our most long-lasting relationships, right? How important is it to surround yourself with positive people? So this next round of questions really talks about how important is networking and choosing the appropriate supporting cast. I'm going to start with Ms. Cunningham, and then we'll work our way around, and then we're going to open it up for questions for those of our viewers, okay? All right, Ms. Cunningham.
Awesome. So networking is extremely important, as we all know. And, you know, you don't know who people know. So I may be having a conversation with you in the airport, and you may know the next person that I need to get in contact with, and they might know someone else. So you always have to be ready to set a first impression, no matter where you are, whether you're in the airport, grocery store, you don't know who the next person knows. So it's extremely important to keep that in mind when you meet different people, because you may think, oh, that person may not have anything for me. They have no connection to me whatsoever, but you don't know who they know. And they could lead you, you know, to your next opportunity just by having, you know, a short conversation with them. But having the right people in your corner was the most important thing for me in my career. I know I wouldn't be here without the network that I had within the golf industry, whether there are people that look like me or people that don't. There are tons of people who have had my back and who have put me in the right doors and put me into the right conversations to excel in my career. So it's extremely important to have that network, because at the end of the day, you can't do it alone, and you're not meant to do it alone. You're supposed to have people behind you and in front of you that are going to help you get to where you need to get to. So, you know, just like, you know, we mentioned earlier, you know, you're not the only person in the room. There are other people there that have helped you get there that will continue to help you throughout your journey. So so networking is definitely key. And without my network, I wouldn't be here today.
Wow. Awesome. I love it. Be ready. Stay ready. You never know. Like you said, get ready. Stay ready. Ms. Higgs, Dr. Higgs, would you, Dr. Burkhalter, what's your view on that networking and surrounding yourself?
I think it's absolutely essential. And I will say to people that you should be careful about who you include in your circle. So absolutely network. I carry around my digital card, letting people snap it on a regular basis, because you really never know to whom you might be connected or need to be connected. But also be careful about who you allow into your sphere. Not everybody is going where you're going. Some people can't understand the vision that you have for your life. And so that discernment word comes up again. When you think about where you're headed, then think about who can help you along the way. You need mentors. You need supporters. You need cheerleaders. You need spiritual guides. You need people who are going to encourage you when you're discouraged. And so my sisters and I like to call it our posse. You need to get a posse of people. Many of them will occupy different roles in your life, but they all play really important roles. Like, I don't go to my mentor when I want to have a pity party. She's not going to cheerlead me. She's right. going to say, you're a leader. Get it together. I'm going to need you to leverage your skills. But sometimes I need to go to somebody who I know will provide me with encouragement and support. My daddy is always going to have a word for me, because he's a pastor. He's a minister. He's got a scripture for all the things. And so if I need some spiritual, you know, influence in my life, then I know I can go to him and he will provide that. And so be careful with whom you surround yourself, because if you surround yourself with the wrong people, they can pull you down when really your journey is about ascension. You want to go higher.
Yes, I love it. Surrounding yourself with the right people. Ascension, right? Awesome. Miss Mobley. You hear us, Miss Mobley?
Yes, the network is critical. Can you hear me?
Oh, okay. Yes. Uh-huh.
The network is critical. I would add that authenticity and excellence is critical for bringing value to any networking situation. We are able to get through and persevere to the levels that we have through understanding that we have to perform. We have to be good and we have to be efficient. And oftentimes the best or better than anyone else in the room to have our positions and to maintain it. That's a lot of pressure, but really that is the equalizer on a lot of levels to be able to be good at what you're doing and to know what you're doing. If you have that reputation and people can understand it and you have that authenticity, people want to engage you and they understand that you are going in, you know, a certain direction. And discernment, of course, is key, but people want to do business with people they respect and like, trust. So on many different levels, you want to have those qualities available to preserve or to offer up to someone else to add value to their network as well. So be conscious of that.
Absolutely. I love that. Like, I love what you said about, I mean, it's sometimes it's so simple too. People are going to align themselves with who they trust. It's one of the most simple things, right? So key. Dr. Galagos, you're going to close us out on this last question, and then we're going to open it up to questions from our viewers.
Well, my colleagues made it easy because they answered this question so perfectly. And what I have to add is this, I wouldn't be here in this session if it wasn't for networking, because that's how I met the wonderful Dr. Brown. I think the challenge with networking is finding that space that allows you to be yourself, to be able to be accepted, and for you to accept others. And when you open yourself to that level, you start meeting people of all different backgrounds. Mm-hmm. And that's the networking that happens. And when I way back, and this is for my students who are listening, you think that you need so many people. You feel like you have to have this huge circle. And if it wasn't for the number of people you have, then maybe you aren't that qualified. And the truth is that it's quality. Mm-hmm. It's the quality of the people within mm-hmm. your circle that helps you build your posse, as was mentioned, that helps bring in those authentic folks who really mm-hmm. want the best for you, who you will feed off of their energy, who you will grow to either aspire to be or inspire others to become. And I feel like that's really the true essence of networking, is that it's not just about what are you going to do for me? It's how I can help you, because I may not need you, but you might need someone who I know who can help you to the next level. And that's the beauty mm-hmm. about networking, is that it's just so open and it mm-hmm. does flow in all directions as long as you allow it to. So mm-hmm. I appreciate that question. And I love the answers from my colleagues. And I just really want my students to hear this, that no matter where you're at, it's the quality that matters the most.
Yeah. And you hit it, Dr. Galagos. One of the best parts of my trip going to NASPA, that was my first time going to NASPA. And we met, and we just clicked. And we've been staying in touch, and it has been wonderful. Do y'all remember the movie A Girl's Trip, and they talked about Flossie Posse? Well, Dr. G, I'm going to call you Dr. G for right now. You just gave us a new one, and that's Quality Posse. So that's what our students need. Forget the Flossie Posse. It's important to have a Quality Posse. So this has been amazing. We could stay on here forever, but what I want to do is give our viewers a chance to drop some questions for us in the chat. So we'll give them a few minutes. Here we are, Dr. McNeil. And you all know Dr. McNeil. I have to give a shout out to Dr. McNeil for helping us get what we're supposed to be today. And Dr. McNeil's question, what piece of advice do you have for the men? How can brothers support the vision and goals of Black women? Thank you, Dr. McNeil. What are immediate concrete ways brothers can uplift Black women? I'm just going to open it up. So whoever, like, if you raise your hand and tell me how, if you want to answer or take this question, anybody would like to take this one? All right. Great.
I'd be happy to take this. I'm married to a beautiful Black man, and it'll be 23 years this year. And so, but to the advice to men in general is, do not be afraid of the strong women in your life, and know that behind every strong woman, there is somebody who is providing her with a level of support. we need a soft place to land. We need somebody to encourage us. We need somebody to believe in us. My greatest cheerleaders are my dad and my husband. They believe when nobody else believes. They encourage me when no one else does. They remind me of my spiritual center. They remind me of what I'm capable of. And so give us a place and a space where we don't always have to be the strongest one in the room. Give us a place and a space where you pour into us as we pour into others. And I think you can do that irrespective of whether or not you are married to someone. You can do that from a friendship perspective. You can do that as a brother or to someone or somebody who's in a friendship group or one of those posses or mentorship groups that we talked about. But for every person who is out there being strong, there are moments when we too need to be fortified. And I think men can play that role very nicely.
I love that. Anybody else want to add to that? I wrote that one down. You said, give us a soft place to land. I'm talking about it. Dr. G.
I'll add to that is that while we love that soft space to land, I love that my husband does not try and solve my problems. Let me be just vulnerable for a minute and continue to support me by just listening and giving me an auto girl every now and then, or giving me that swift kick in the butt and telling me, stop feeling sorry for yourself and get out there and keep doing and keep pushing, because that's why you're feeling what you're feeling, because you're making that difference. And so I just feel like that support, that holistic support all the way around, from being that supporter to allowing us to be vulnerable, is just really important as we continue to grow, because as we grow, we change, we evolve, and we appreciate the acceptance all the way around through all those pillars that we go through.
Awesome. Great. That was a great question, Dr. McNeil. Do we have any other questions from our viewers? We are winding down. I mean, I knew, I said, you know what, with this group, 60 minutes isn't going to cut it, but we're going to try to get, yes, Ms. McCullough, she's got a question for us. Yeah, well, she's giving us a statement. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Ms. McCullough, for joining us. We appreciate that. These are great comments. So with our last 5 minutes, I know President McCorn was on here, and I'm going to see if he has any questions. And if not, what I want to do, guys, is with these last 5 minutes or so, is allow each of you just to give our students that last little bit of advice. You know, that last little bit of advice, if it was one thing that you want them to take away. Okay, so we'll start with Dr. Biggs and work our way around. Dr. Higgs, work our way around.
So, you know, I would love to take credit for this one I'm about to give you, but this one, again, I have to attribute directly to my father. And he always says that, you know, and he says it this way: God plus hard work equals success. I modified it a little bit. Faith plus excellent work equals success. And so the thing with that is, you need the faith, but it's not enough. You have to do work, and you have to do excellent work in order to achieve success. And the last thing I'd add to that is, you need to define what success looks like for you, because success can go so far beyond what we've been taught in the places and spaces where we were raised. Sometimes when we ascend to the next level, success brings with it a lot more possibilities. So take a moment and redefine success for yourself, but never forget the faith, the excellent work is essential to achieving success.
Love it, love it, love it. Faith plus excellent work, not just work, excellent work. Absolutely love it. Ms. Mobley, are your last words of advice?
Oh, wait, it's hard to top that one. Really, perseverance is where it's at. It's going to take, I like to use that word, grind. It's going to take something that's worth having. Anything that's worth having is going to cost you. You got to sacrifice for it, and you have to be focused on getting yourself there. Self-awareness, I would offer to have everyone have it at top of mind. I mean, these days it is kind of top of mind in the way we discuss things in our society after the pandemic, I guess. But to have a sense of self, or seek a sense of self, is paramount. with those tools, self-awareness, and understand that the journey is going to cost you, but it'll be worth it, is really where it's at.
Yeah. Wonderful, wonderful. Being able to pay, like I mean, you said it, nothing really worth having is going to come without, like you said, some discomfort. Being, we have to be willing to pay that price, right? What's the saying? Heavy is the head that wears the crown. And but I do believe the victory is on the other side of the struggle. Absolutely. Ms. Cunningham.
Yes. Yeah, so first I'll say be comfortable with being uncomfortable, for one. Two, don't compare your journey to someone else's journey, because everyone's timing is different. Stay focused on your why. That's the most important thing that has gotten me through every single thing in my career and in life, is just understanding what my why is. And that makes it a little bit easier. You have to work harder than the next person, because you can't let anyone else outwork you, especially people that don't look like us. We have to work a little bit harder. So you never want that to be something that somebody could say that you didn't work hard enough. Understand that your failures will lead you to your successes, and you just have to be patient throughout the process. It's a difficult thing to be patient, but you have to learn how to have faith, and you have to be patient through the process to get where you want to go.
You're gonna make me run through a whole nother pen. Be comfortable being uncomfortable, and your failures will lead to success. Unbelievable. Great. That's unbelievable. And remember your why. Remember your why. That is an awesome advice. That's awesome. And last but not least for today, Dr. Galagos, if you would drop that last little bit of knowledge for us. Before you get started, I want our students to know, every single one of our panelists, if you know, they're writing. I can see they're taking their own notes, which I want to add to this conversation. A successful person never becomes complacent.
Yes.
So even our successful people are learning from each other. If our students and viewers are watching, because I'm watching you guys taking notes and just processing it, that we can continue to be learners. So yeah, I just wanted to drop that in. Dr. Galagos, you bring it on home for us.
You all have been beautiful and have said so much. I would only add to be open, be present, allow yourself to have those feelings and be vulnerable. And with grace, share your story, because someone's always listening. Someone's always watching. And it's not to compare, but it's to give hope. It's to build that bridge. It's to help them pave their path. Don't stick with status quo. It's okay to be different. In fact, I challenge you to be different. Find your balance, whatever that might be, and always, always go mad. And what I mean by that is make a difference. By making a difference, you help pave that way for others. And so just keep pushing. Don't stop. Don't be afraid. And when you are, listen to that intuition, as Dr. Burkhalter was saying, and just feel it and show it and live it. You have to live it.
Amazing. Absolutely amazing. I want to thank every single one of you. I'm going to be mad all day, Dr. Galagos. I'm going to be mad all day. Listen, that's the way to end it. Be mad all day. Go out. Each of you have given us life lessons, right? To go out and be mad all day. I want every one of our students and our viewers and our supporters to be mad all day. Go out with the items that you've given us and make a difference. So thank you, ladies. It has been absolutely wonderful. To our viewers, to our students, thank you for sharing your time and part of your day with us here at Clinton College. So it's been great. We're now going to turn it over to our announcements with Miss Katie Stansbarger.
Good afternoon. I'm here with this week's Bear announcements. Registration is happening now, so if you aren't registered, please see your advisor for registration, and you will receive a free Clinton College t-shirt. Please join us today in the multi-purpose room at 1:45 for our watch party. We're going to cheer on the men's basketball team in their first round of the national tournament. And this Friday, we have Shamrock the Yard from 1 p.m. to 3 p.m. Come out and enjoy mocktails, music, and more.
Thank you.